So talking about energy, there are many ways to talk about energy, many issues. I would like to concentrate on energy sources, and I would like to concentrate on those energy sources which have a global perspective. What you can see here on the diagram, and now somebody, I think, had a laser pointer. I can just throw it once more. I'm very happy that you did not take me. Okay, this diagram here just shows you the use of energy in Europe, and it shows the industrial use, the household use, the services, the agriculture, and ultimately transport. And this diagram shows how the energy use increased this over the years. It of course shows the dip because of the economic problems we had. It shows that the use in household was more or less constant, but the household use is only a minor element there, a minor part of importance, and therefore let me say, when people say we have a new installation, let me say a new wind farm, and this accommodates 57,000 households, this only addresses, let me say, one element. Very important is, of course, to recognize that transport has increased over the years, and also the aviation. Air transport is a major part of the increase. I would like to start and say a few words to fossil fuel, and I just, let me say, highlight what I think is of importance and relevance there. So this is sort of the story then, of course, of oil, coal, and gas. The issue of oil is the question, for example, whether the oil peak has been reached. The oil peak would be the maximum in exploration and the maximum in production. And of course, for many countries, the oil peak is over. We are on the other side of the slope. And this is shown here for the case of Norway. It shows the oil production over the years, starting from 1970 till 2010. The different colors just highlight the various sources. The maximum was around 1995, and the same fate has happened, let me say, to UK and the production there, to America. And the question is, did it also happen globally? On the right side, you can see the global oil production again over the years and where we are. Are we now at the maximum? Or does it continue like the IEA expects? Or is there a decline indicated also here? And there are many serious, I think, sort of scientific efforts which indicate that indeed the peak might have been reached. And there is also some circumstantial evidence, because the oil price is increasing since 2006, but the market does not respond as usually the market would respond under the circumstances, because the supply does not increase. There are other indications, let me say, the request of the IEA to open the strategic reserve in order to level the price rise. One also has to recognize that new oil fields have a difficult accessibility, and the new oil has indeed lower quality. So far, what I wanted to say the oil. Now, the gas story is a totally different aspect. It has not the aspect that the supply decreases, quite the opposite. Technology has been developed to open what people call the shale gas areas. The technical term is fracking. And the technology which makes this available is the technique to also drill holes horizontally. And this is obviously a revolution, at least locally, for example, in the American gas market. And when you look at the development of the yellow area there, this is the shale gas embedded in all the other gas forms. And when you look at 2010, how... Okay, that's enough. So this is the shale gas area there. When you look at 2010, you can already recognize the substantial increase of shale gas. The consequences are very striking, because, for example, the original idea to go back into nuclear energy supplies and build even new reactors in those states, this I think is put on the back burner because the potential is tremendous. The environmental issues in gaining this gas are rather critical, but I will not go into any details there. Also in Europe we have shale gas, for example. Poland has a lot, Germany has something, France has something, but I think they get already a loan not to exploit it because of the environmental conditions. But nevertheless, the game is somewhat changed over the next years or so thanks to this technology and the shale gas. Of course, these are fossil fuels with the environmental consequences which we all know. I don't go through the canon of the various observations, expectations, arguments. And discussing then fossil fuel, of course, then one has to discuss the CCS technique, the carbon capture and storage, the sequestration, and its prospects. So to remove the CO2 from the power plants is obviously a chemically and well-controlled technology. The consequences of this technology and we say efficiency and prices, I think, is known, and it is in the range of something like 10-15% or so. The problem of storage is the major issue. The transport issue is again something which is technically solved, and the storage is of course mostly geological and of course then also an environmental issue and a societal issue. In that sense, will people accept it? The quality criteria, if one would like to bury it ultimately in voids and caverns under the earth, is the injectivity. So how much of the gas, what is the injection rate at the expense of the pressure difference, the pressure gradient we have to utilize. And the issues are geological issues, the sediment architecture and permeability, the ratio of vertical versus horizontal permeability, the inter-reservoir areas, neighborhood to extra-reservoir sediments, the mode of water displacement, whether this is piston flow, or let me say fingering, that the water moves into the environment in terms of, let me say, like in the structure of fingers. And in the essence, and therefore I'm summarizing this, a lot of detailed geological knowledge is necessary to qualify a field for this process. And there is a conflict, because in order to get the necessary geological knowledge, you have to drill a lot of idea to ultimately store in this volume CO2 over centuries. So this, I think, is a problem CCS in principle is. Now coming to nuclear energy, and again rather briefly because of the time, the consequences of the Fukushima were now the installation of filter ventilation, actually to the operators of Fukushima, GE, the General Electric, has given this advice many, many years before the accident. Now to utilize mobile equipment to handle total blackouts, for example, to have better instrumentation and specifically permanent cooling of the fuel rods, and to create emergency teams with corresponding equipment. So this is sort of the institutionalized response. Of course, it is necessary to learn from this accident, but this is always the way in technology we go ahead. A couple of days ago, people are reminded about the Titanic accident 100 years ago. And of course, also there, again, we were reminded of what were the consequences of this in terms of safety on the ship and safety on the sea. So the same situation, of course, happens here. But for my taste, something is missing. An international agreement, better agreement than what we have, to clearly separate the interests in profit on one side and the interests in plant safety on the other side. I think this is something which is still, at least for my taste, missing. There is no time now to talk about the passive safety of generation 3 reactors like they are now realized in Finland or in France. Neither can I talk about the favorable features of generation 4 reactors under research. But of course the question remains, are the safety issues of fission better served by prolonging running reactors to 60 years or beyond, utilizing add-on safety elements, or are we better served, or is safety better served by realizing new reactors with intrinsic safety features like the new concepts have them or promise them? So I cannot speak about this, but nevertheless, I would like to point out one element, and this is the environmental elements that those who operate fission reactors, that they benefit from a reduced CO2 production. And this is very clear when you look at France, Sweden and Switzerland. This is very clear now when you look into the per capita CO2 production in connection with electricity, because they are extremely low in comparison to other countries like Germany, for example. But they also pay off, let me say, and you can see when you just look into the CO2 emission per capita connected with the overall energy production in this country. Now, this is mostly electricity produced nuclear, of course also hydro, to a larger fraction, but nevertheless, it portrays, it characterizes this aspect of the power supply, and when you compare this, let me say, with Germany, then you can really see the difference there. And when you compare it with Denmark, which is very similar to Germany, then one can see that, let me say, 20-25% of wind energy obviously does not very strongly modify this value there. So this tells us, let me say also at the end, that there is a trade-off, at least each society has to take the trade-off between the risks of nuclear energy on one side and the risk, the environmental risk of CO2 production on the other side. Now coming to the technology change. Of course, it is necessary that we change our technology out of various reasons, the environmental reason, the reasons of finite supplies, and of course, let me say, the political reason of becoming less dependable on imported energy. Now let me first place the overall task in the right perspective. Here you can see the global primary energy consumption of the world from 1992 to now, and it is continuously rising. This is something which we of course understand in terms that the population is rising and the per capita use of energy is rising. And now this is the tremendous amount of energy which we are consuming annually on the Earth. Now here, there you see the splitting in oil, gas and so on, but this is the renewable part. So the red line is the new renewable part, you can see it here once more. And because hydro power is explicitly shown here, the renewable energy carried by the other sources is 1.3%, and now when you isolate here the solar power and the wind power, it is 0.02, respectively 0.25%. And this is the technology now which we have to scale. Now, just to go through a quick thought experiment, when we think about 2050, 9 billion people on Earth, and now the question is, what do we expect? And of course, everybody expects something different. One could expect, let me say, that the oil consumption is unchanged, because transport is a very complex element to change technology there. Coal being very dirty, maybe it's reduced by a factor of 3. Gas may be reduced by a factor of 2, because it also produces CO2. Nuclear is unpopular, so it is moved out. Hydroelectricity may be increased by a factor of 2. Bioenergy may be also increased by a factor of 2. The consequence would be that wind and solar then have to be increased by a factor of 250, which is of course tremendous. But this under conditions that the average consumed power now is 2 kilowatt per person. This would mean, let me say, that we have to sacrifice quite a few things, because we are the society which consumes something like 5 kilowatt continuously. So this again, of course, is a nonsensical example, but it nevertheless tells us, of course, it is a complex endeavor to change the technology. Now I would like to briefly comment on winds, solar and bioenergy, and this is bioenergy. You see the rapes fields here, just in front of my institution here. So this is fusion here, the institute which we have built in Greifswald. But this is not what I want to say now. I would like to talk about bioenergy. And I need a reference, and this is simply the annually driven kilometers in Germany, which are 690 million kilometers. Sounds terrific. When divided by 82 or 80 million people, then it is just something like less than 10,000 kilometers per year, which is sort of average. Now when we think about, and I will show you many examples of Germany, which of course is understandable because I just can collect data there. On the other side, maybe the German example would be the best because we have the energy wende, we will change our technology. The biogas which we produce in Germany, mostly from corn, corresponds now expressed in this sort of terminology that 1 hectare produces ultimately 71,000 kilometer, which is 6.7% of our annually driven kilometer, whatever. But biogas is not used for driving cars, it's mostly used for electricity production. Biodiesel is mostly produced from reps. In this case, 1 hectare gives you only 18,000 kilometers, 2.5% of what we annually drive, and 50% of the harvested energy is used for the production. So this is, of course, one of these critical elements in bioenergy that one has to very much in detail ultimately assess the CO2 balance and the energy balance. Now, bioethanol comes from cereal, sugar beet in Germany. 1 hectare produces 27,000 kilometers, 1.6 of this figure here. This product requires a large energy use, 80 to 90% of the harvested energy, and it's always sort of a gamble. Does it make it or doesn't make it? Finally, BTL diesel, FD diesel, sun diesel from bio waste, wood and straw and others. The technology is sort of developed, but has to be improved. And one area gives you 55,000 kilometer, but in Germany we don't produce very much, so this is not yet, let me say, a major player in the game. Now, important is that we can scale those things. Of course, Brazil produces sugarcane, and a lot of its traffic is based on this, and also other countries produce biomass, and this is rather favorable and should, of course, be supported. But what is, let me say, the global expectation, and I resort here on studies from the Swedish Academy. We have one representative here, and the material I got from Sven Kulander. And these are the numbers, and for those people now at the end, hate to look again after a long day at numbers, I have the same thing here in columns. Columns, so we have 140,000 terawatt hour on global energy production. I've shown you the results, 80% are in fuel. When we look into the total energy in transportation, this is 25,000 terawatt hours. The global biofuel production at the moment is 50,000 terawatt hours. The energy content in food is 7,400 terawatt hours. When you divide this by 7 billion people, then of course you end up in the 100 level where we exist, where we live. And when you put where to transfer this into biofuel, utilizing all the food, this would be about 3,700 terawatt hours. So what does this mean? We have to increase the biofuel production by a factor of 500, and we have to increase the food production by a factor of 7 to meet this. And again, this tells us it is, of course, possible here when, and there when the local circumstances allow this, but this will not be a solution. And this will specifically not be a solution when you think about that there are still 850 million people starving, that we will have around 9 billion people on Earth 2050, and when you think about the consequences, deforestation, biodiversity, and all the other arguments. So the basic problem of bioenergy is that 1 hectare area produces this energy in a year. When you utilize the same area and replace it with photovoltaic panels, the harvesting factor is much larger. So when you think about electricity or electric cars, maybe this would be the way to go. There is, let me say, the ethical justification of using biomass of the second generation, which is mostly, let me say, using waste. But I don't think biomass has a global perspective. It may have a perspective, let me say, ultimately for air transportation, but also this would mean that biofuel has to be increased to something like 1,000 terawatt hours from up to now 50 terawatt hours. Also, this is for sure a challenge. Now coming to photovoltaic. Electricity, just by introducing, showing you the tremendous development which we have for two countries in Europe, Germany in yellow and Spain in green. And this is the annual increment in power, peak power. So we have here now 2010 something like 8 megawatt, meanwhile we have distinctively more. So this is this increase from year to year, and the total, sorry I made a mistake, the total I think of Germany is 27 gigawatt meanwhile. And this increment was drastically stopped in Spain from 2008 to 2009 because the driving element of this development is now not, let me say, an environmental consideration, but it is simply, let me say, the feed-in tariff system in its various forms that is employed. That people in Germany, for example, give the insurance that their capital investment has an interest rate of something like 8 to 10%, that this is insured over 20 years. It's an economic drive behind this development. And this went out of the hands in Spain. When you look at this drastic development there, therefore a correction was necessary, and the feed-in tariff system is much less favorable now. Similar development in the Czech Republic. They have basically stopped this, and the PV income now is strongly taxed there. Of course, in France and UK are specific responses, because this development is simply economically too drastic, but nevertheless, of course, it is what we are looking for, the change in technology. Coming to photovoltaic, if I only discuss this, I cannot talk about solar thermal and others, is of course a simple, sustainable and versatile form of electricity production, and it of course has a tremendous appeal to physicists. But there is a high primary energy needed to produce it, and there is also a tremendous material use. So at the end, of course, it's a very expensive energy form. In Germany, and we are not famous for a lot of sun, for vacation, all the Germans leave the country. Photovoltaic systems, I think, are not economic. There is a lot of research potential in systems with higher efficiency with new materials or systems with lenses, high power cells, timing systems for a better use of the solar spectrum, cheaper materials, thin layer technology, organic polymers, cheaper production techniques like the Chinese have demonstrated to us. And maybe also possible breakthroughs in nanotechnology, quantum dots, and lots of many other techniques. Now, jumping to wind energy. And again, I only introduce here the installed power, very strong in Germany and Spain, the rest of Europe coming, but also in China. We normally are aware about the use of coal in China, that every week, every 2 weeks or so, a new power coal burning power station starts operation. But of course, they're also investing in other renewable energy forms here in Linz. And I would like now to discuss a little bit in more detail the consequence now of an intermittent source. Because wind blows not always and sun doesn't shine during the night. And the intermittency is of course a new aspect. Mankind always tried to protect it against the intermittency of nature. And now we transform our energy system or hand over our energy system now again to processes of nature which are of course intermittent. So here is in 2010 the installed power of photovoltaic panels in Germany. And this is the power which we get over the years from January to December. And of course the maximum is in summer and there is nothing then in the winter months. Now when we look into the wind, 2010, this was the installed power I mentioned already. So this is something like 27 gigawatts here. And this is the wind power as it developed with strong contributions in the winter and weak contributions in summer. And this is ultimately the demand, the load curve, again in the same period here, with winter having high demands here and the summer having lower demands. And to make this, just by way of introduction, we discussed this in two terms. The lower level is the base load, so there is nothing in here. We have to provide this and above, but we don't have to go beyond the peak load, though the energy demand is just within a belt between the base load and the peak load. Now to show this variation a little bit in more detail, this is now a month, this is now July, this is January. This shows the loads, and you can see here the 4 weeks here, from Monday to Friday we are busy needing energy, then on Saturday, Sunday we don't need much. And this repeats itself at this level in July and at a higher level in January. And this shows now the photovoltaic contributions which we enjoyed in Germany 2010. Of course, this is very periodic because it just marks the day, the sunlight. And this is the low level of wind in blue, and this is the opposite here. You can see a little contribution by sun. This obviously was a sunny weekend here, which we enjoyed in the blue is the wind. So this is sort of the scenario. And utilizing now the data I had from 2010, other people do the same, and the nodes, I can now scale up things and see, let me see, how does this develop now when the contribution of wind, photovoltaic, and so on increases. So this is again the node from mid-February to mid-March, the data I have shown before, and this is now the situation when I add now, I scale it up so that the wind, the onshore wind contribution is 10% of the overall electricity we need in the year. This is in Germany something like close to 600 terawatt hours, so this is now something like 60 or so terawatt hours, 10%. And one can see that the basic periodic characteristics still remain there. And this is the situation which we have in Germany at the moment. Now when you increase this to 30%, then one can recognize that the whole thing becomes more erratic, because it now just portrays, if you see, the erratic nature of wind. To 50% it becomes very erratic, and ultimately the concept of the base load disappears, and everything now is basically determined by sort of peak loads because of the fluctuations, and this of course at the end will also affect the price of electricity, which will move from the base load level to the peak load level. And one can also see that there are periods where no additional power is necessary because the wind produces everything. So maybe I didn't make this very clear, but I showed here is sort of the backup power and how the backup power has to vary. Not very much in this case, it's the same like here. But now with 30% wind, the backup power becomes erratic. Of course, the power stations have to be operated now in a totally different form. And this ultimately, let me say, leads to the operation of the backup power systems in an erratic manner, not, let me say, guided by the base load and the peak load any longer, and not guided by the periodicity and the predictability which we had in the past. This is a totally different operational mode, which up to now we don't have distinctively in Germany. So in order to discuss this in a little bit more depth, I transfer this time series diagram into a histogram, and I plot now the power against, let me say, the frequency, the number, this distribution shows up in this distribution with the base load here and the peak load there, and of course nothing in between here and nothing beyond this. And now we study again what I did before, we just add wind power. So this is the diagram again, this is the load without any wind. And now when we add 10% wind, 56 terawatt hours, the wind contribution 10%, as I said, the backup capacity now is used up to something like 69%. It's not used to 100%, it's never used to 100%. In this 10% case, its economic use is 69%. Now when we go to 30%, we can now see, let me say, that the idea of base loads disappears because this part now is filled up because there's a wind contribution and the power systems only have to work at a level of 20% or something like this, and in the average the backup capacity now is only used for 58%. So the base load disappears here, and even we get now negative contributions because at this part we have periods where wind produces all the electricity which is needed, even somewhat more, which goes beyond, and this is the surplus which is produced there. So this is the situation now which further expands. When we go to 50 or to 100%, in this case, but what we also can see when we go to 100%, we can see very large power contributions, not very frequently, but exceedingly large. And we can also on the other side see that sort of the maximum, the peak load is not modified very much. We can only save here something like 5 or 10% of the installed backup capacity, because of course there are always then periods where there is no needs, and then you need the full capacity. Or maybe the full capacity minus the 5 to 10%, because this is always wind which is sort of available. So ultimately wind power saves fuel, but does not replace power stations. But this of course not. Now when we go to the extreme, of course nobody would go to this, it's just sort of a redundant experiment to analyze and highlight the situation. So when we have this case, we produce all what we need, but of course, let me say, also we are producing thereby the fraction of surplus. Then in 3,400 days, we produce more electricity than necessary. So 1,740 terawatt hours do not match. the demand, and therefore they have to go into the export into other countries. Or one charges 40 million cars 43 times. Or one produces, let me say, harsh, or does something else. And under these circumstances, because we have power which does not match, we still need the backup power, but their capacity now is used to only 25%. And this is the problem. The economy of the backup power supply systems, are they still operated economically? And this is something I think in Germany we write we now experience, because of course the large utilities are hesitant in producing new power systems. Now to think a little bit, go a little bit deeper into the issue of storage, when we go back to the time series representation of the loads, the wind which contributes to the loads, and the surplus, which we don't need. Of course, we still have gaps, but we are producing a lot of surplus power with high power levels here up to 300 gigawatts. And this would be the onshore situation, when there's a drastic variation there. And this would show now the offshore case. Here, the situation is much more constant because of the high wind power. The turbines often have to be operated at constant power. There's a difference to the onshore case. And this is the photovoltaic case, where we produce a lot of peak power during summer, but nothing in the winter months, December and January. So when one now analyzes, let me say, the situation with the surplus, then the dispatched energy, the one which directly is used, increases, but of course does not increase linearly. It saturates here because of the surplus power, which is to be used in a different form. And this curves for offshore, onshore and photovoltaic power, which are analyzed here, do not, of course, fulfill ultimately the power demand. And one needs a lot of power, specifically for photovoltaic, let me say, and this goes much beyond, let me say, the conventionally installed power in Germany, and the peak power load which we need here, which is around 80 gigawatts. So this would be, let me say, the dispatched energy which goes directly into the grid. This is the backup energy which is additionally needed, and of course this goes down for these three cases here. It goes down at least for photovoltaic. And this is ultimately the surplus power. And I have stopped the calculations here. When the surplus power just matches the backup energy, sorry, when the surplus energy, annual energy, matches the backup energy, because the idea, of course, now would be to put this into the storage and then replace the backup system. So then, of course, one would have a clean situation. So the storage is the major issue. But let me first summarize the consequences of intermittency. Wind and photovoltaic save fuel, but they do not replace power stations. The second set of backup capacity is necessary, which binds capital costs. The peak power is not reduced much, 5 to 10%. Their periods of operation, however, is strongly reduced, and this is then the question of the economy. The base load idea disappears, which means the price of electricity rises to the level of peak electricity or something in between. And the surplus electricity, of course, has to be used. This now would show the necessary storage in terawatt hours against the time over a year, so from January to December here. And this is the curve for photovoltaic, and for photovoltaic one needs a lot of power. And let me say the story of this power reservoir would be that one starts in December at a certain level, and this, because the sun does not shine, the storage is exploited till a zero is reached here. Then ultimately the sun comes, then the sun overshoots, and then again the more darker months comes, and then the whole thing is consumed again. And this is photovoltaic, this is offshore, and this is onshore, and the red I will mention in a minute. So for each of the case, it is such that one uses the full capacity, which of course one would never do. Just to say in this scooping studies is the case. One of course has to make sure that we end like we started, so that we can continue here. And what we can also very nicely see, what we knew before, they are just out of phase. One can optimize photovoltaic and wind by mixing them correspondingly. And if one has, let me say, 50%, 48% onshore, 20% offshore, and 32% photovoltaic, then one has an optimal mix optimal mix in the sense that under these circumstances, the storage is lowest, which one needs. And this is the red curve here, and you can see, let me say, when you compare the wind, the photovoltaic case, that now indeed the storage is much lower. And this would be the cycle of sort of this optimal system, the optimal mix between wind and photovoltaic. So here it shows again the situation which we would have when we had a national solution in Germany alone. So the stored energy and the power which is to be provided by a system for wind on alone, wind offshore alone, photovoltaic alone, and the optimal mix. The optimal mix would need, if you say, 17 terawatt hours capacity and a quite tremendous power, 190 gigawatts. Of course, one could do this differently. But just to set again the frame. And in order to make this a little bit clearer, one can compare this with the specification of the three gorge dam in China. This has a capacity of 84 terawatt hours, and the power is still much too low for what one would need, let me say, to balance the fluctuating elements in the power situation there. What this ultimately would mean, let me say, for Germany, one would need an installation like this installation in China to cope with the problem of storage. So this is what I wanted to tell you. The storage is, of course, the solution, but it is a tremendous problem. The solution can only be seen, let me say, in politics, because we would need a European-wide grid. And there are many studies, specifically from the Aarhus University, where they show that the capacity demand strongly decreases in the frame of a European grid. But this, of course, would require, and this is sort of the political element there, that we agree, let me say, on a similar nature of power supplies, intermittent versus steady state. And I do not see, let me say, that we are on a very good way there. And of course, in technology, we need something which can be scaled. This is what I, at the end, would like to say, and this probably can only be chemical storage, of course, supported by all national circumstances which allow storage. Of course, in the Alps in Austria, you have wonderful storage. There are tremendous storage possibilities in Norway, but something which can be scaled can only be a chemical storage, and the development of chemical storage very much depends on the catalytic processes, on the catalyst itself, and this in the Max Planck Society, we think, is an effort which will take a few decades. Okay, at the end, if you ask 5 minutes, or should I stop with this? Just to round up, let me say, talking about long frames, fusion is also long frame, so maybe I just can round up, but I'm very brief there. So nuclear fusion would be my last topic, and then we are done. Fusion, of course, is very successful. It supplies the universe with energy. In the core of the sun, we have the appropriate conditions, which is high temperature, high density, and the total high pressure. Under these circumstances, matter is in the plasma state, and here we have a big plasma ball. The essence of the energy gain is, of course, the equivalence of energy and mass, the special relativity, the relation there, and what the sun is doing. It burns 4 billion tons of mass per second and transfers it into energy. And the fusion energy which is released there maintains the sun and also the fusion reactor in the future, maintains the condition to allow, let me say, the self-sustained burning. What we want to do is utilize the principle which is based here in toto on the fusion of 4 protons into helium, providing energy. And this is what we would like to do, to build a fusion reactor like ITER, it was already mentioned today. A magnetic confinement system which utilizes deuterium and tritium, producing also helium as the ash. A neutron is the major energy carrier and in total energy. Okay, I think I explained already all this. Now the pros and cons of fusion power would be deuterium is in the seawater everywhere. Tritium is produced from lithium, and this is in the crust. Actually, Austria has a lot of lithium in its mountains. So at the end, this would be an inexhaustible energy source. The fuel is distributed equally on Earth. There is no CO2 production, no uncontrollable power excursion, no critical afterheat, no radioactivity. We have to work with tritium, but this is produced in situ inside the reactor. And the other negative element is we, deuterium, tritium fusion, involve a neutron. This activates structural materials and they can be radioactive, not the fusion products, the structural material. But the situation there is that the byproducts are first well confined and they decay within about 100 years. So they don't have leading physics terms, like for example the half time of plutonium, which is 24,000 years. So the decay is something like 100 years, and then one is in a hands-on situation. So to characterize this a little bit plakativ here, the deuterium in the water, the tritium or the lithium taken out of three major stones, larger stones here, put into a fusion reactor, which unfortunately does not yet exist, but this would ultimately then give the electricity of a family, this tremendous potential of fusion, and this ultimately drives this research field. The most successful fusion device is the tokamak, a Russian invention. The confinement is not like in the sun, with gravitational forces, we have to use magnetic forces. This would be a talk in itself, which I just cannot deliver out of time reasons. In Germany, we are building in Breslau the large accelerator, and you can see how artistic our coils are. But of course, in the coils, there is a lot of very interesting and very rudimentary physics. And as I said, it would be an interesting story to tell this, but it's not possible. So this is JET, the largest tokamak, which is operated close to Oxford. Here you can see the device from the outside, here you can see the device from the inside with the man. Now this device operates with deuterium tritium, then the man is replaced by the machinery here. And the machinery is doing everything inside there. And this device now is covered with beryllium, so the all the inner walls are with beryllium, so it's a very large stock of cosmic rays.